So this is a direct address today, or a message, to anybody who's listening, or anyone who not sure whether you're hearing the voice of God or whether you're hearing the voice of the devil. Today, some very practical things. You know, when we look around our nation today, how many of you, the thought goes through your mind, what in the world is going on? What is happening to this country? How many of you have heard such outlandish things being said, like, and these are direct quotes, these are things that are happening. A four-year-old children have the right to choose their gender. I mean, I cannot wrap my brain around it. I cannot. The stupidity of it. Our kindergarten children are being taught about LGBTQXYZ, and there is a teacher who instructs students to pledge allegiance to the gay pride flag after she removed the American flag because it made her a little uncomfortable. Or that abortion is legitimate for population control. Now, these are real quotes. Oh, yeah. These are what's being put out there by government. Not the woman who's making everybody pledge allegiance to the gay flag. But this one takes the cake. It's a recently published quote, which says, a University of California medical school, get it now, medical school professor recently apologized to his students during a lecture saying, I said when a woman is pregnant, which implies that only women can get pregnant, and I most sincerely apologize to all of you. This is a medical professor in a lecture to medical students at a medical school. Have you ever in your life, how many men have you met who are pregnant?
Stupid.
Absolutely. But even more concerning is what you hear concerning the body of Christ. That's pretty amazing. More than 50% of professing Christians now think that Jesus is not the only way to salvation. Jesus. Now, these are Christians. 50%, more than 50%. The latest I saw was 60%, but more than 50%. And priests at various levels of the Catholic hierarchy, I'm not coming against Catholic, I'm just quoting the truth. Priests at various levels of the Catholic hierarchy in the U.S. and the Vatican are using a gay dating app. The most recent Barna poll discovered that 56% of respondents who identify as Christians and who attend evangelical churches, as well as 62% of Christians who say they attend Pentecostal churches, profess that having some type of religious faith is more important than which faith you align yourself with. In other words, we could put it this way, just believe anything you want to believe. I mean, it's better to at least believe something than not to believe anything. That is a lie. That is a lie that can pave your way to hell. Yes. You say, well, these things don't matter. Yes, they do.
Yes, they do.
They are directly coming against the word of Almighty God. Yes. They do matter.
Yes.
They do matter. They do matter. When asked if one could qualify for heaven by being good or doing good compared to the belief that salvation comes only from embracing Christ as Savior, 41% of professing evangelicals said that if a person is generally good or does enough good things in their life, they will earn a place in heaven. That's a lie.
Amen.
It's not popular to say that's a lie. But that's a lie. And maybe you sit there and say, well, I know my neighbor and I know anybody else. They're really good people, and I believe they're, I mean, they don't, they're not a Christian. That's the problem. They're not a Christian, but they're really good people. Really? Good based on what? There's only one way to heaven. And it's through the blood of Jesus Christ and believing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. There is no other way. You can't buy it. You can't be good enough. You can't be kind enough. You can't bless nations enough. You can't feed enough. You can't. No. You can't give enough clothes, enough goods, enough anything. Just, you can't be a good humanitarian. You just cannot be one, a philanthropist. You cannot do any of those things that make you get in heaven. It's one thing only. Yes. That you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And accept him as your Lord and Savior. That's it. Yes. Period. The church is in trouble. It's no wonder the world is in trouble. If the church were not in trouble, the world wouldn't be in trouble. But thank God we have been given insight, we've been given understanding, as well as correction and direction in the Word of God for times like these that you and I find ourselves living in. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 1. Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are his dear children. Live a life filled with love, following the example of Christ. He loved us and offered himself as a sacrifice for us, a pleasing aroma to God. Let there be no sexual immorality, impurity, or greed among you. Such sins have no place among God's people. Obscene stories, foolish talk, coarse jokes, these are not for you. Instead, let there be thankfulness to God. You can be sure that no immoral, impure, or greedy person will inherit the kingdom of Christ and of God. For a greedy person is an idolater, worshiping the things of this world. Don't be fooled by those who try to excuse these sins, for the anger of God will fall on all who disobey him. Don't participate in the things these people do, for once you were full of darkness, but now you have light from the Lord. So live as people of light, for this light within you produces only what is good and right and true. Carefully determine what pleases the Lord. Take no part in the worthless deeds of evil and darkness. Instead, expose them. It's shameful even to talk about the things that ungodly people do in secret. But their evil intentions will be exposed when the light shines on them, for the light makes everything visible. This is why it said, "Awake, O sleeper, rise up from the dead, and Christ will give you light." So be careful how you live. Don't live like fools, but like those who are wise. Make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. Don't act thoughtlessly, but understand what the Lord wants you to do. Don't be drunk with wine, because that will ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, and making music to the Lord in your hearts, and give thanks for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You know, we could spend our entire time this morning on that one verse. All I'm going to say is the verse which says, imitate God in everything you do. I just want to make a notice here. It's not a suggestion, it's a command. Amen. Imitate God. Paul doesn't stop there. He addresses immorality, greed, foolish talk, and inappropriate speech. He urges us not to be fooled by people who rationalize their sins. Amen. And reminds us that we are people of light and that you and I should walk in light, because we are people of light. Focus on verses 10 and 11 with me from that same chapter. Carefully determine what pleases the Lord. Take no part in the worthless deeds of evil and darkness. Instead, expose them. We're going to, you know, I'm going to park on those scriptures there for a minute. You know, we're in peach season, and if a peach tree stops bearing good fruit, a wise orchard person knows that there's a problem with the root system. For the quality of any fruit is really based on how good the root of the tree is. Let me give you a quote. Every ungodly, corrupt, and evil thing that is happening across our nation and the world has a root. There is a root cause for everything that you and I see happening. Satan is at the root of every evil and corrupt decision, behavior, and agenda that is operating on the earth right now.
Amen.
And he does his evil work through people. Every anybody who has an evil agenda that is opposite from what the Word of God talks about and what the Word of God puts forth. My friend, you have a bad root.
Amen.
And that is, you have never given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ and you have never allowed Him to guide your life. The darkness is still in charge of your life. And you have not let the light push the darkness out. 2 Corinthians 2:11, it says, Paul wrote, that Satan should not outsmart us.
Amen.
For we are familiar with the devil's evil schemes. Or in other places, we are not ignorant of his evil schemes or plots. Or his schemes are capable of drawing careless Christians into sin. His wiles of the devil,
yes.
Plots to get you, schemes to trip you. So how does that happen? How does the devil outsmart us? The Lord said, I'm going to give you five strategies. Five strategies the enemy uses to trip me and you up and to outsmart us. Number one, self-centeredness. And that means to be overly concerned with one's own desires, needs, interests. Those who always talk about themselves, make every issue about themselves, and are generally about me, me, me. Now, you do know all of this comes under the banner of pride. We were taught about pride before, didn't we? Pride. The very one who was cast out of heaven, if you remember, because of pride and ego, wants to pass his sin on the church.
Yes.
And the church, hey, we buy it. We buy it sometimes. The book of Proverbs has many verses on pride and humility. I just picked one. Pride leads to disgrace, but with humility comes wisdom. Proverbs 11:2. You can never overestimate, really, the power of humility in our walk with God and with each other. Humility is not only pleasing to the Lord, it's also a protection for you and me. I remind you that the only time in the Gospels that Jesus said, learn of me, the only time that he said, learn of me, was in reference to his humility.
Amen. Amen.
That's interesting, isn't it? We need to remind ourselves that our ego should have died.
Amen.
On Calvary.
Right.
Let's look at Colossians 3. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. So, number one, self-centeredness. Number two.
What is God's will for your life? Sandra teaches simple yet powerful keys for God's children to be still in His presence in order to focus and receive clear direction and answers from Him. She also reveals how your character, attitude, and words have power in extending your days. Why not take advantage of the principles God has set in motion in order to add length to our lives? Order this package and allow this book and two teachings to bring a glorious transformation in your life.
Number two, deception through wrong associations. Now, We're talking about strategies that the devil uses to trip you up or to outsmart you. Deception through wrong associations. Look at 1 Corinthians 15:33. Do not be deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals.
Amen.
You know, most of us are not stupid. Most of us know when the company we are associated with is not helping us. But we like the money they spend on us. We like the attention they give to us. We like just how they think we are great and wonderful. And so we overlook the bad jokes, we overlook everything. And when you read bad company, it's all too easy to relegate it to evil people, wicked people. Well, there's much more than that, Lord, much more that the Lord is talking about. For instance, bad company, his definition, actually means hanging around with people who do not contribute or strengthen your walk with God, but turn your attention away from God. In other words, they don't see God in things. You hang around with people who are gossips, that's bad company. Because before long, you're going to be agreeing with them and gossiping with them. You hang around with people who are negative and critical all the time. People who tell off-colored jokes. People who are always finding fault with someone or somebody at the church. That's bad company. For long, you'll be agreeing with them. The Bible is very clear on this point. Look at Romans 16:17. Now I make one more appeal, dear brothers and sisters. Watch out for people who cause divisions and upset people's faith by teaching things contrary to what you've been taught. Stay away from them. There's also a scripture in 1 Corinthians that says, I appeal to you, dear brothers and sisters, by the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, to live in harmony with each other. Let there be no divisions in the church. Rather be of one mind, united in thought and purpose. 1 Corinthians 1:10. The Lord doesn't like people who cause divisions. Before Paul gave us the list of fruits of the Spirit, he bluntly classified for the Galatians the fruit of the flesh, and they're found in Galatians 5:19 through 21. When you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. I want you to notice that Satan goes around looking for those he can recruit to his agenda. Don't be a candidate. Amen. It's like somebody say, here, you can use me for a while. You got to remember, he successfully recruited, the devil recruited, 1/3 of the angels. He successfully recruited Judas, and he almost got Peter. So let us not be casual in the area, but watchful, diligent to avoid the appearance of evil.
Amen.
Look at Titus 2:12. And we are instructed to turn from godless living and sinful pleasures. We should live in this evil world with wisdom, righteousness, and devotion to God. Number 3, talking about strategies that can trip you up, or how the devil can outsmart you and me. The enemy wants you to accuse God.
Amen.
When God doesn't do what you ask him to do, what you pray for him, when he doesn't do what you want it and it doesn't come out like you want it, when you think God's not listening, when you think God doesn't care, when you think God cheated you out of something. A lot of people have left churches because of that. The enemy will come along and give you 72 reasons or 172 reasons why you should be mad or at least disappointed with God. This next scripture is a blistering scripture. Malachi 3. You have said terrible things about me, says the Lord. But you say, what do you mean? What have we said against you? You've said, what's the use of serving God? What have we gained by obeying His commands or by trying to show the Lord of Heaven's armies that we are sorry for our sins? From now on, we will call the arrogant blessed. For those who do evil get rich, and those who dare God to punish them suffer no harm. That's what bitterness will do to you. Bitterness will destroy your life. One of the most frequently attacks the enemy uses is to get you thinking that God's not fair. Amen. That God's nicer to some people than He is to you. Getting mad at God, accusing God, is never a good idea. Amen. Jealousy of other people's blessings is a form of accusing God. Envy of other people's possessions is a form of accusing God. And the devil loves to use these tactics against you. Because Satan wants you, he looks at you as a prize to be won. Yes. I'm not going to be his prize. Amen. Church, guard your heart. Guard your mind. Because the more you fill your mind with the Word of God, the least susceptible you will be to what the devil is trying to do. Number four. The devil, the strategy to trip you up and outsmart you, he wants you to buy the lie. Yes. Disciples, whether extreme or minor, overturning the truth or buying the lie, that's exactly what the devil wants you to do. Buy lies. Buy them. He works at getting you to believe a lie. Any lie will do. And yet, he's a liar all the way around. He wants you to lie, to believe the lies of celebrities, all them movie stars. He wants you to believe the lies of your government, of politicians, of advertisers. He really likes to trap you with advertisers. So that you buy things you don't need. If you don't think the devil is involved in advertising, somebody needs to slap your face. Very much involved in it. And he loves to get you to believe the lies of the mainstream media. Oh, yes. You do realize, don't you, that what you and I call mainstream media is really propaganda. Yes. 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 It's also reported that Karl Marx said to a friend, it is the first duty of the press to undermine truth. Yes. That's communism. How many times have we said things are not the way they appear? They are not. Number five, listening to the enemy's suggestions. You know, you don't want to own the devil's suggestions. Claim them as your own thoughts. And that's what he does. He makes you think what you're thinking. He makes you think so you get so confused. That you get so confused, is this me or is this the devil? And you get all confused. Enemy lies that you think that his thoughts are your thoughts. And they're not. Remember, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, and Jesus is the only truth there is anywhere. Yes. Satan is mean. He's cruel. He's brutal. He's heartless. He works to see that people are destroyed. This message is about exposing his worthless deeds of evil and darkness so that you won't be caught off guard when he comes around your house to play with your mind. We could do good to remember 1 John 3:8. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. Generals try to study their enemy in order to know how to conquer them. 2 Corinthians again, Satan should not outsmart us, for we are familiar with the devil's evil schemes. We know the wiles of the devil. We know what he's a thief, he's a deceiver, he is an accuser of the brethren.
Yes.
You and I need to decree all the time, I have the mind of Christ.
Amen.
The night before he died, Jesus said this to his disciples, Luke 22. But you are those who have continued with me in my trials, and I bestow upon you a kingdom, just as my Father bestowed one upon me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Glory to God. Have you kind of gotten it in your head that the Lord doesn't like fair weather friends? Here today, gone tomorrow. There's a huge crowd that followed Jesus, but the Bible says at one point, the Lord has said this to me many times. There was a huge crowd who followed Jesus, but the Bible says this. Many no longer walked with him because what he taught and what he said. They liked it when things were going their way. They liked it when he fed them. They liked it when he did this and that. But when he began to narrow things down, they walked away. Once we commit to being his disciple, he expects us to continue with him. Over the years throughout the body of Christ, there have been many who started well, but they did not end well. They drifted away. It's not starting the race, friends, that matters. Finishing it that matters. The rewards belong to the faithful. You could have been born at any time in history. You didn't choose to be born now. God chose you to be born now so that he could use you to be a light in the darkness. He knew something about you, didn't he, that we forget. He knows who you are in him. And because he chose you, he saved you, he justified you, he taught you, and empowered you to come through this time in absolute truth and victory.